In the last video, we looked in depth at the physical and chemical barriers that line the surface of the body to repel, detect, and destroy potential pathogens. However, as we have all experienced, sometimes these physical and chemical barriers are not enough, and the outer layer of our defences can be breached. When this happens, the soluble and cellular components of the innate response come into play, and we will be mainly looking at the cellular components in this video. Let us imagine a scenario where we have a tissue infection. In this case, a bacterial infection that has breached the outer layer of our defences. The epithelial cells in the areas surrounding the breach release a host of cytokines and chemokines that activate resident tissue mast cells and macrophages. These cells in turn release chemical mediators like histamine, which act to dilate blood vessels in the surrounding area, which in combination with the chemical trail from the chemokines, helps recruit immune cells from the circulation to the site of infection, in particular neutrophils, which then phagocytose the invading bacteria. So let's go back and look at the different types of innate immune cells and some of the soluble mediators and their function in the second line of the innate immune response. Remember, immune cells are derived from hematopoietic stem cells, and in the innate response we are mainly talking here about cells that derive from the myeloid lineage of hematopoiesis, with natural killer cells being the exception, coming from the lymphoid lineage. The first family of cells we are going to highlight are the granulocytes, which include neutrophils, eosinophils, and basophils, which all belong to a family of cells called polymorphonuclear cells, because they have a characteristic multi-lobed nucleus, as well as the mast cells, which lack this lobed nucleus. All these cells have numerous cytoplasmic granules that contain a wide range of antimicrobial peptides that can help destroy threats. Neutrophils are the most abundant white cell in our body. About 60% of circulating leukocytes are neutrophils, and they only enter the tissue after they receive a signal coming from the inflammatory response. The primary function of neutrophils is phagocytosis. They can bind and engulf pathogens, and are particularly effective against extracellular bacteria and fungi. Levels of neutrophils will rise during these types of infection as signals are sent back to the bone marrow, telling the stem cells to produce more neutrophils, as that is what is needed to help contain the threat. Eosinophils are a much rarer type of granulocyte, with less than 5% of the circulating leukocytes being eosinophils. They can also be tissue resident, where they help maintain tissue homeostasis. Levels of eosinophils will be higher in individuals who are or have recently suffered from a parasitic infection, as that is what these cells are primarily responsible for defending us against. But they are also implicated in the allergic response, so will be elevated there too. Basophils are even rarer, with less than 1% of blood leukocytes being basophils. And again, these are implicated in controlling parasitic infections and in allergy. But more recently, immune modulatory effects have been discovered that help regulate the immune system. Although all these cells contain cytoplasmic granules, the contents are quite different, which reflects their different roles. Neutrophils have a few different types of granules, which mainly contain enzymes and other biologically active substances designed to disrupt pathogen cells. Eosinophil granules have some very specific preformed cationic proteins, as well as cytokines, chemokines, and growth factors. Basophil granules contain similar types of substances, but they also release pharmacologically active mediators like histamine that contribute to the inflammatory response. Neutrophils need to be recruited to the site of infection via a chemokine trail. Once they migrate from the blood into the tissue, they are able to carry out their primary function of phagocytosis. Neutrophils engulf foreign particles into a self-contained intracellular vesicle called a phagosome, which then fuses with the intracellular granules to form a phagolysosome. The contents of the granules is released into the phagolysosome and results in the destruction of the ingested pathogen. Eosinophils, on the other hand, tend to release their granule content into the surrounding area, which when you consider their primary role in the defence against parasites such as multicellular worms makes sense, as these parasites are too big to be phagocytosed. They can release granules in four ways: classical exocytosis, compound exocytosis, piecemeal degranulation, and cytolysis. They are important for maintaining homeostasis in a variety of tissues, including the intestines, uterus, lungs, and thymus, as well as within adipose tissues. Basophils also have roles against parasites in allergy, but their emerging role in immunoregulation is becoming more important, especially in the context of hypersensitivity. Mast cells are very similar to basophils, but are tissue-resident cells. They are granulocytes, but not polymorphonuclear cells, so their nucleus takes on a more traditional shape. When mast cells are activated, they release their granule content into the surrounding area, and one of the main pharmacologically active agents here is histamine, which is responsible for the classical signs of inflammation that we see, including the redness and swelling around the inflamed site. Leaving the granulocytes behind, we are now going to look at monocytes and macrophages. Monocytes are bloodborne, making up between 2 and 10% of blood leukocytes. Their main role is phagocytosis and bacterial killing in the blood. Macrophages are a type of differentiated monocyte, and they're found in the tissue. There are two types: resident macrophages, which populate almost every type of tissue in our body very early during development, and these self-renew throughout our life within those tissues to provide local protection. Then, during infection, these are supplemented by inflammatory macrophages, which derive from blood monocytes, but undergo changes as they enter the tissue, becoming larger, with an increasingly complex number of organelles and hydrolytic enzymes, as well as an enhanced phagocytic capacity. Unlike the tissue-resident macrophages, these inflammatory macrophages dissipate after the inflammatory result is resolved. The last of the myeloid-derived innate cells are the dendritic cells. Dendritic cells are also found throughout the tissues of our bodies, but only a tiny population circulates in the blood. They are prominent at the sites of potential entry points for microbial invasion, where they specialise in antigen uptake and presentation, providing a link between the innate and adaptive immune systems. After they phagocytose a threat, they migrate through the lymphatic system to the lymph nodes, where they interact with T lymphocytes and help initiate the highly specialised adaptive immune response. The final cell types we are going to look at in this video are the odd ones out, in the sense that they are produced by the lymphoid lineage, and these are our natural killer cells and innate lymphoid cells. The reason we include these as part of the innate response is because they lack the ability to form immune memory. So although they have many properties in common with lymphocytes, their response is the same every time they encounter a specific type of threat. Natural killer cells make up between 5 and 10% of the circulating lymphocytes, and they are a large granular cell that target virally infected or cancerous cells. They destroy those cells through the release of cytotoxic granules, requiring cell-to-cell contact to do this. And like eosinophils and basophils, they also have emerging immunoregulatory roles that are only now starting to be understood. They express a group of receptors called killer inhibitor receptors, or KIRs, that enable them to recognize damaged cells through receptor-co-receptor interactions. So, they receive activation and inhibition signals. And it is the balance of these signals that ultimately determines a cell's fate. If the inhibitory signals are equal to or outweigh the activation signals, then nothing happens, and the NK cell will detach and go on its way. If, however, the inhibitory signals are lost, which often happens during viral infections as the virus tries to hide within a cell, or when our own cell becomes cancerous, then the NK cells become activated, releasing cytokines and a granule protein called perforin onto the infected cell. As the name suggests, this perforates or punches holes into the cell membrane, resulting in cell lysis. Please note that there are many, many more receptor interactions than illustrated here, so there are multiple inhibitory and stimulatory signals being received by the natural killer cell at any one time. The final type of cells we are going to discuss briefly are the innate lymphoid cells, as they have only recently been described. There are three main families, ILC1, ILC2, and ILC3, and they appear to play a role in barrier integrity and homeostasis, so they are often associated with the epithelial cells, where they drive wound healing. But they've also been implicated in barrier diseases like eczema. So that's a summary of the innate immune cells and some of the many different roles that they can carry out in the innate immune response. In the next video, we will start to look at some of the soluble mediators of the innate immune response and how these act in tandem with the cells of the innate system to help defend our body from threats.